dogs and cats, and that there are some new therapies that have been coming out, and it's kind of been a while since this has been happening. This is just a slide that lists some of the companies that I speak for, and I'm on the advisory board for QBiotics, and I'm speaking for Kindred Bio tomorrow. If you haven't been to one of my other talks today, I'll be giving out some free stuff. So this will sign you up for my newsletter, which you can, of course, unsubscribe afterwards. But if you haven't yet done it, please take out your smartphone. I'll be giving away a pair of digital calipers at the last talk. You have to be there to win it. But in case you're not going to be there, I will be giving away two pair of plastic calipers at the end of this talk and every talk as well. I also have a bunch of caliper pens, which I've been carrying around and forgetting to give out, so I'll give out some of those as well. So to do that, please text Dr. Sue, no spaces, to 444-999. No spaces, no punctuation. Sometimes autocorrect will try to mess you up with that. And you will get a series of messages back on another thread asking for your name and your email. And then you know you will be successful when you get a message asking you to hit a link, which will take you to my YouTube channel, which I am asking you to please subscribe to my YouTube channel. So if you could do that for me, I would be super fantastically appreciative. Okay, so what are we going to be talking about in the next 50 minutes? We're going to be talking about some new chemotherapy drugs. We're going to be talking about Tenobia for lymphoma. We're going to be talking about two chemotherapy vaccines, the lymphoma vaccine, which I'm not really using, and I'll tell you why and why that might be changing. We'll be talking about the osteosarcoma vaccine, which I'm super excited about. We'll be talking about a novel diagnostic, the BRAF testing for TCC and uroepithelial carcinoma. Is anybody using that yet? Oh, good, that's great. And so this is a really good test to know about in practice, both for really for diagnosis, but I'm also using it for monitoring as well for my cases. And then we'll talk about Entyce and Mirataz as well, which are drugs that I'm really excited to have in my practice, and not only do I think are they really helpful, obviously, for treating cancer cases, but I think just in everyday practice in so many of our cases where getting them to eat is a challenge. All right, so we're going to start with Tenobia. How many of you guys are using Tenobia in your practices? Okay, how many of you give chemo in your practice? Okay, so how many of you treat lymphoma cases? Okay, good. So this is a drug to know about, and we're going to be talking about more about lymphoma maybe in the next lecture. I just do whatever they tell me to. But let's talk about Tenobia, because this is a new drug that's been on the market, I want to say for about a year and a half, maybe 2 years. So, you know, lymphoma review, we've talked about this a couple different times in other lectures. Lymphoma is a very diverse group of cancers, a little bit more consistent to talk about in dogs than in cats like we did in the last lecture. So it's a malignant transformation of lymphocytes. It's a systemic disease that requires chemotherapy. It's one of the most common cancers that we see in dogs. And this is a cancer, my motto across the board when I treat dogs and cats with cancer is live longer, live well, right? So obviously we want our pets to be living longer, but if they're not living well, I don't really want to be treating them. So it's really important that they have a good quality of life, not only after treatment, but during treatment. And so why I think that fits for dogs with lymphoma is they have very high consistent response rates. So with a multi-agent chemotherapy protocol, 80 to 90% plus will have a complete remission, and achieving a complete remission is very important. And they have significantly improved survival times, 1 month versus 13 to 14 months for dogs that go on a multi-agent chemotherapy protocol. And these dogs also live well, so they tolerate chemotherapy very well, and not only, like I said, do they have a good quality of life after they finish chemo, they're enjoying their life as they're going through chemo, and they're usually free of clinical signs during their treatment. And most owners that start to give chemotherapy to their dogs continue to come back during their pet's chemotherapy protocol, and they're very pleased with their dog's quality of life. But we need to have options. Not everybody can afford to do a CHOP multi-agent chemotherapy protocol, and I really think that's one of the places where Tenobia is going to fit in our different chemotherapy options. So this is a chart that I kind of just put together, and there I have a longer chart, a more detailed chart in our lymphoma one, but I kind of wanted to highlight the main protocols that most oncologists are using. So a CHOP multi-agent protocol, very high complete remission rates, median survival time of about 13 to 14 months. Single-agent doxorubicin is my next favorite protocol for dogs with B-cell lymphoma. 60 to 80% of dogs with complete remission, and usually a median survival time is about 7 to 9 months. that has a long maintenance protocol, a little bit lower complete remission, a little bit shorter median survival time. Not my favorite protocol in dogs because it has a very long maintenance protocol. These dogs have to keep coming back every 3 weeks. So, but again, it is a good option. Low muscine, not a great option up front, right? You guys can see, very low complete remission rate. There's not a lot of good studies that show how long dogs will be in remission with low muscine alone. But again, usually pretty short, and you can see why it's not a great option as our first line protocol. And then PRED, usually 50% remission rate. If we just use that, if owners decide not to do chemo, in 2 to 3 months is how long they'll usually live. How long do they live without chemo? Usually about a month. Okay, so what is Tinovia? Tinovia is a new drug, CA. What does that mean? It's conditionally approved. So this means that we have to use the drug according to its label. Its name is rabifoxidine. I have a hard time saying that, so I'm going to call it Tinovia. It's an IV drug. It's conditionally approved. FDC, the company, has 5 years to continue to show that it's safe and effective, which they're doing lots of studies for it. So it's been shown to have complete and acceptable safety and reasonable expectation of effectiveness to get the conditional licensure. You can't use it besides how it's labeled, and I'll tell you how it's labeled. So they have up to 5 years to make sure and that it will be fully labeled. Then you can use it off-label for other chemo or for other cancers and stuff like that. But right now you can only use it according to the label. Oh, I meant to take this slide out. Basically, it's a prodrug that's activated and it's toxic to lymphocytes. But I don't think that that's important. Okay. So you can use this according to the label for dogs that are first diagnosed with lymphoma, or you can use it when they relapse. So they looked at multiple schedules were evaluated. Most dogs evaluated by 7 days after they got their first dose of Tinovia, and they usually responded for about 130 days, so about 4 months. If they were pre-treated, meaning they saw other chemo, it was usually less, right? That makes sense. Dogs that have seen other chemo usually don't respond as well than dogs that haven't seen other chemo. We know that across lymphomas, you know, in general. In general, 77 overall response rate, about a 45% complete response rate. This is for dogs that were newly diagnosed and relapsed. And again, it includes dogs that have seen other chemo drugs that are going to bring those numbers down. But again, I still thought that was pretty reasonable. So again, these were newly diagnosed lymphomas, but what's cool about this, guys, these dogs aren't coming in weekly. These dogs are coming in every 3 weeks, getting 5 doses of Tinovia. Not bad for, you know, an alternative protocol for owners that maybe don't want to do multi-agent. And again, they use this also for dogs that have relapsed lymphoma. So it's recommended to start at a 1 mg/kg. It's given as a 30-minute infusion. Dogs did better if they got this higher dose than if you started at one of the lower doses on a recent study. You give it every 3 weeks for up to 5 doses. If they're having side effects, you want to do stepwise dose reductions, which makes sense, or manage them. You know, if they're having side effects, you're going to do dose delays like you normally would. And obviously, if you're not giving chemotherapy, I wouldn't recommend starting with this drug. You have to use a closed system and all of the other, you know, safety precautions, personal protective equipment, and all the other things. So you should be comfortable giving cytotoxic drugs if you're going to be giving chemotherapy, if you're going to be giving Tinovia. So we talked about this as conditionally approved. What can I use this for? The cool thing is you can pretty much use this for any lymphoma. You can use this for B-cell lymphoma. You can use this for T-cell lymphoma. You can use it for high-grade. You can use it for low-grade. You can use it for any anatomic site. It can be pre-treated with other chemotherapy as well. So again, it can be first-line therapy for dogs that have relapse. In the study, they did not use it with PRED. They did not use it with Serenia. They did not use it with diarrhea medications, but it is not against the label to do that. So it has what I say a pretty generous label for conditioned license label. And some conditions license labels are really strict. Like you can't do anything with them. So I thought that it had a really nice label. This was one of my first cases that I gave it to. This is Maya, sweet little thing. So again, you know, it's always kind of scary to give, you know, new drugs to your patients. But again, I think as long as you're very proactive with your chemotherapy, just in case medications, I find that it's very well tolerated. What's interesting is there's a study that just came out in 2017 where they gave it to first-line therapy, so these dogs were not pre-treated with other chemotherapy, so these dogs had lymphoma, and they alternated doxorubicin with Tinovia. So the cool thing about that is a couple of things. One is they have different mechanisms of action. So that's good. I was, you know, that's why I chop multi-agent chemotherapy. from different angles, different drugs, different mechanisms. So that's cool. The other thing is, doxorubicin's a heck of a lot cheaper than this new drug, Tenobio, which is still on patent, right? So doxorubicin, if I can alternate Tenobio with that, I'm gonna be able to bring the cost down in practice. And so they alternated it, again, with the doses that you're used to using. It was generally well tolerated and actually brought up the response rate, which is what you would expect. Usually if you combine two drugs that are effective, you're gonna have higher response rates. So again, the median progression-free interval was 6 months. Dogs that went into complete remission did a little bit better. But again, this is comparable for docs-based multi-agent protocols with less visits. So again, I think this is a really good option and I'm really excited about it. And the other thing is all these gray bars on here, guys, are CHOP protocols. This is the only one that's not a multi-agent chemotherapy protocol. So this is to highlight that docs and Tenobia, doxorubicin and Tenobia, are pretty much lining up with the other CHOP chemotherapy protocols. I think that's pretty cool. That's all I want you to take away from that gray and red chart. And then the other thing is, I told you they have 5 years to show that it's effective. The other cool thing is they have a lot of studies with over 350 dogs where they're using it for other cancers, a feline lymphoma one. So I think that to see the company that's making it is doing a really good job showing that it's safe and effective. Here's one looking at cutaneous T-cell lymphoma, multiple myeloma, leukemias as well. So there's a lot of studies ongoing. I would expect that we're going to start to see a lot of other uses for it, and hopefully it will be fully licensed in the next couple of years. So the conclusion so far, it's active against naive, so again, dogs that haven't seen other chemo and relapsed lymphoma, has a very broad label indication. It's recommended every 21 days at a mg per kg. It's efficacious and convenient. What we're also seeing from a lot of the studies coming out is giving it to dogs earlier in their chemotherapy career is probably going to be better than, you know, giving it as when they relapse for the fourth time, right? That makes sense. You're nodding your head, so that makes sense. Good. The combination of doxorubicin, really excited about that. I think it's a great option. Tenobia with doxorubicin is definitely becoming my Plan B protocol for owners that don't want to do CHOP multi-agent chemotherapy for B-cell. So we'll talk about a little bit more in the lymphoma talk. We want to be very proactive with our GI medications. You want to watch them for, you know, any neutropenias. There is an unusual dermatopathy. They can have sort of itchy skin, so we want to, some oncologists are keeping them on low-dose PRED at a half to 1 week per kg when they're on Tenobia. Some oncologists are not using concurrent PRED with it. And then there is an unusual side effect where some dogs are getting pulmonary fibrosis. It is on the label as well, but it is also contraindicated to use this drug in Westies. It is against the label because Westies are predisposed to pulmonary fibrosis. Guess what was the first dog that wanted to use Tenobia in practice for me? A Westie. Well, the owner of a Westie. So again, that's something else to be aware of. And then there's a pivotal trial starting this year as well. Okay. So again, this is that chart that I showed you, but I've now put Tenobia in there about 70 to 80%, and then I've added Tenobia and doxorubicin. So again, I'm really excited that I think this gives us some new options, and it's kind of higher up on the chart, which I'm really excited about. All right. This was Nettie. This was the first case that I gave, the first case in practice that I actually gave. It's always a little bit scary, like I mentioned. Maya was one of the early cases that I gave as well. And this owner was really scared about GI side effects. And I have to say, of all the side effects that I mentioned, prolonged anorexia and nausea seems to be one of the more serious side effects. So I encourage you to use Serenia and Entyce. And that's what I do in all of the dogs that get Tenobia, is they get injectable Serenia. How adorable she is. To get injectable Serenia with their Tenobia, and then I have the owners start Serenia and Entyce orally for a full week after. She was really well trained. She was an agility dog. Unfortunately, we just didn't know any of her tricks. She was like, just give me the treat, I will do. She was adorable. So again, she relapsed a year later. We went through a second cycle of CHOP. And then she relapsed after that, and that was when she went on to Tenobia. At that point, she was just getting single agent. She had already maxed out on her doxorubicin, and I believe at this point that alternating study had not been out. But again, very preventative, so she got her Serenia IV, start Serenity and Tice preventatively orally for a full week after. And this dog had, she had had multiple inappetence issues with doxorubicin and vincristine, but had none when we were very preventative with her genomia. This is just her running on the beach. And we'll skip that due to time. All right, so let's talk about the lymphoma vaccine. Anybody using the lymphoma vaccine? A few hands. And so, you know, the lymphoma vaccine has actually been on the market for a while. And I actually did, I have to tell you, I have not used it, and I use the melanoma vaccine. And so the concept is pretty similar. It's the same company that makes the melanoma immunotherapy vaccine. And so the idea is if you give a dog antigen of itself, if you give a dog antigen, it's not going to recognize it because it's itself, and it's not going to have any immunity. But if you give it human or mouse antigen, it's going to be able to build response and develop immunity. And that was really the concept that was used for the dog immunotherapy melanoma vaccine. And so the same company, Marietta, which is now BI, was working on a lymphoma vaccine. And there was an early study in 2008, Phil Bergman also developed the melanoma vaccine, where they looked at dogs, and it looked like the dogs that were getting this, and this was a safety study, but they had increased survival with the lymphoma vaccine. The problem was is that the vaccine was released and there was never really any good studies that showed that it was improving the survival times. It was shown to be safe, that was a safety study and it looked like, but it was a very small number of dogs. And then a lot of the oncologists were really waiting for those studies that showed, like I showed you with Zenobia, is it improving progression-free survival? Is it improving response rates? And so it really did not get a lot of use. And so the good news is there are some new studies that are starting to show some benefits. This is an immunotherapy, just like the melanoma vaccine. It's a DNA vaccine. It targets B cells, so the CD20. So, what's the take-home message for this? You need to know if your lymphoma dog has B cell or T cell, right? You need to phenotype these dogs. So, don't, you know, if you have an owner that's not going to let you phenotype, I wouldn't be using the immunotherapy vaccine. How does it work? The antigen is taken up by the host cells, it's transcribed, and then presented to the immune system. The immune system is going to recognize it as foreign and then hopefully attack those lymphoma cells. But again, if you give it to a T cell dog, it's not going to work. It only works for B cell lymphoma patients. So what are the issues of it? So the vaccine is just like the melanoma vaccine. So it's a needleless injection. It's given every 2 weeks for 4 treatments and then it's boosted every 6 months. It was the same technology that was used for the melanoma vaccine. Like I mentioned, there was little efficacy data, and the problem was originally it was recommended to give them the CHOP chemotherapy protocol and then start the vaccine. The problem was it takes 2 to 3 months to develop this strong immune response, and that's usually around the time the dogs were relapsing, and that's probably why we were not getting good efficacy, right? So you're doing chemo for 6 months, and then you're vaccinating over 2 months, and then it takes 2 to 3 months to develop an immune response. That's around the time most dogs are relapsing, right? Usually most dogs relapse about 4 to 5 months after being off chemo. So the idea was maybe we should be using the vaccine early. So there is a new study that's looking at giving dogs with B cell lymphoma CHOP, and the vaccine is started in the second cycle. And they're looking at that versus CHOP alone, and it looks like it's increasing or improving survival by 4 months. So this is not published yet, but again, there's a recent trial undergoing. And so again, now there's a double blinded placebo study. So again, I think we're gonna start to see better results if we start using it earlier. So what they're recommending now is potentially after completing the first cycle of CHOP, after the first doxorubicin, maybe that's when we should be, it was started in the second cycle. Okay. So the canine osteosarcoma vaccine, so this is from Aratana. We talked about osteosarcoma this morning. It's the most common primary bone cancer that we see. It's locally aggressive, right? So dogs present for lameness and swelling, and they're painful. These tumors cause bone lysis or bone reduction or both. But what is it that the dogs die of? They die of metastatic disease, and that's really the challenge. Even if we do amputation and chemotherapy and delay metastasis, it is the metastasis that the dogs succumb to. And so we really need better therapy. So we can do palliative. We talked about amputation, pain medication, palliative radiation. Definitive therapy in most dogs is it's going to consist of amputation and chemotherapy. Yes, we can do limb-sparing chemotherapy. We can do stereotactic radiation and chemotherapy. But for the majority of our dogs with osteosarcoma, it's going to be amputation followed with chemotherapy. But again, what do they die of? They die of meds, usually to the lung. So we want to start chemotherapy 10 to 14 days after amputation. The main protocol that is really recommended is carboplatin for 6 doses every 3 weeks. Why do we recommend chemo? It has been shown in multiple studies to improve the disease-free interval and the survival times from about 4 to 5 months to about 10 to 12 months. But again, they're still dying of meds. So this is why we really need new therapy, and this is where the immunotherapy comes in. So again, most dogs that come to meds, usually lungs, negative predictors are the proximal humerus location and an increased outcross. There are some other ones, but these are one of the top ones. And again, I already said amputation, 4 to 5 months, 10% of the dogs are alive in 1 year. With local amputation and platinum, 10 to 12 month median survival time, 50% of the dogs are alive at 1 year, 15 to 20% of the dogs are alive at 2 years. Palliative therapy, palliative radiation alone, median survival is similar to amputation. Okay, so this is how I make immunotherapy fun. The T cell, Mr. T cell. Who likes immunology? Okay. Oh, there's more people in this room. I hate immunology. I hate it, and I hate all this immunotherapy. And one time I had a PhD in immunology in my room. And so I was like, you're going to hate the way I dumb everything down. So I'm sorry, but this is how I make it. Pity the fool who's pressing the cell engine. Okay, so why are we doing this? So basically, when we give chemotherapy, we are giving drugs to directly kill cancer cells, right? Cancer cells are rapidly dividing. We are giving chemotherapy that kills rapidly dividing cells. That's why we hit neutrophils, right? That's why we can affect GI cells. With immunotherapy, it's completely different. So we're using the immune system. For these immunotherapy, we are using the immune system to generate antigen-specific cytotoxic T cells. Ugh, I know. Why do we care? So osteosarcoma is considered an immune-responsive tumor. So dogs that get limb spare and they get infections at their limb spare site, they live longer. It's crazy. Like, and so there's always been jokes among surgeons like they should, you know, spit in the tumor, you know, like don't wear gloves and things like that. So they don't, but I'm just saying. So we know that something about stimulating the immune system is beneficial to the patient, even if it's non-specific. What this vaccine is doing is a specific immune stimulation. So I'm not gonna go into the details because it's kind of like meh. But it's a listeria vaccine, so there's an anaerobic bacteria in there, and it's using HER2-NU. And so osteosarcoma in dogs and people overexpresses HER2-NU, and that is basically the target. So you can see it's overexpressed in 40 to 80% of dogs in their osteosarcoma and their metastatic lesions. So it's a great target for this vaccine. So basically, the dogs get amputated, they get 4 doses of carbo in the study, then they get the vaccine 3 times every 3 weeks apart, and then they're followed up after that. What did they see? And this was really, really super exciting. This was done at Penn. The dogs that were vaccinated, the median disease-free interval was 600 days. The median survival time, guys, was 950 days. 80% of the dogs were alive at 1 year, and almost 70% of the dogs were alive at 2 years. Historical control, so again, we usually talk about 50% of the dogs are alive at a year, about 25% of the dogs are alive at 2 years. And this kind of summarizes some of the different studies up there. So this is what got people really, really excited. The first study that came out was only 18 dogs at Penn, and now Aratana is doing ongoing studies, so that's what AT14 is. So typically, guys, they get a little bit more side effects than chemotherapy. They come in, they are there all day. They can get a fever, they can get vomiting, they can get diarrhea, they get an infusion, they get fluids, they're there all day for monitoring. So they come in at 8 in the morning and they leave at 6 o'clock at night. So different than our other chemotherapy patient, and there's 22 sites in the U.S. that are going through this trial, so it's not available even through every oncologist, but really exciting, and there's this multi-site clinical study going on, so hopefully this will be something that will be available more widely, but I really think this is going to make a positive impact for osteosarcoma. Cool? Exciting, right? And then the other thing is hopefully this platform can be used for other cancers as well. This is Mangus, and this is Mateo, and Mom used to, you know, send me all these pictures every holiday, so when Mangus was going through osteosarcoma, this was my favorite. Mateo then, he had osteosarcoma. so now we're going to talk about the RAF testing, which can be used for TCC and sort of, you know, more broadly, uroepithelial carcinomas. So we're going to start with transitional cell carcinomas, just an overview, the most common urinary tumor that we see in dogs and cats. It's a malignant proliferation of the transitional epithelium, why they're called transitional cell carcinoma. And again, you can see this anywhere in the urinary tract, but usually the most common place that we see is going to be the urinary bladder. In dogs, the most common place that we see it is annoyingly the trigone, because it makes removing them surgically so challenging. We can see it less commonly in cats, and it's usually more apical. So about 50% of dogs will have metastasis at diagnosis, and up to 50% will have metastasis at death. So this is cancer where metastasis is one of the challenges. So, you know, when I talk to owners, I always talk about battlefronts, right? The local battlefront, which is where the tumor is growing. And this is one where we do have that second battlefront, which is preventing the cancer from metastasizing. So we do have that as well. So these can be really ugly cancers. And the hard part about this cancer is their symptoms, their clinical signs, right, are very similar to urinary tract infections. So most cases are diagnosed very late because they're often cases that are treated for urinary tract infections. They're usually in middle-aged and older dogs, and these are the 14 breeds that have the higher incidence. And so these 14 breeds represent a third of all the pure breed cases that will get this cancer. So these are the ones that you should be thinking about, you know, using this test for, especially if they're middle-aged and higher and they're presenting with these signs. I'm gonna read them to you, but again, you know, these are the ones that, any Westies and Scotties are definitely ones that I'm always thinking of, Beagles, but again, some of the other breeds are there as well. Okay, so the problem with these are urinary tract infection signs, right? And so these are the ones where they have blood in the urine, they are straining to urinate, they're going out in their calciuria, so frequent small urination. Dysuria, urinary incontinence. And again, they often have secondary urinary tract infections. So what happens? You put them on antibiotics and they get better for a while. And so again, the problem is that this just leads to late diagnosis, and it's one of the challenges with these cases. They can also end up with partial or complete obstruction. Occasionally they present with lameness. This is one of the cancers that can metastasize to bone. It's not gonna be a common one, but that common presentation, but just something to, you know, file in your memory. If you have a dog with urinary signs that's lame, remember that TCC can, and prostatic cancer can met to bone. But again, you can have a urethral mass, abdominal mass, sometimes it'll involve the prostate, and 30 to 40% of cases may be normal. An abdominal palpation. Okay. So when we run a urine, again, this is very similar to urinary tract infection or cystitis. And will you see the tumor cells? Usually not. Sometimes you will, but often they're really reactive. And a reactive, so remember, the lining of the urinary tract is a transitional cell. So it, you know, is that a reactive transitional cell, or is that a transitional cell carcinoma? It can be really hard. And so again, this is the challenge with this cancer, is how do I diagnose with all of the tools that I have in my practice right now? It's really hard. That's the whole point of this RAF testing, is that the tools that we have are really hard and not very definitive. Ultrasound, it's good, the bladder needs to be full. What do most owners do when they get out of the car before they come into your practice? They let the dog pee. Even when I tell them, even when we call them the day before, the morning before, what do? They let them pee. So that's not good. Ultrasound also helps to look for intra-abdominal metastasis, but if you want the bladder to be able to look for a mass, that's not very helpful as well. Should we be doing cystos? Yeah. So the jury's out. So, you know, there's the concern that it can cause seeding, and some people say adamantly you shouldn't, and some people say I don't know what the risk is, and the literature is kind of mixed with the percent. Growing number consider an FNA of the bladder to be an acceptable and an easy way to get the diagnosis. But again, I usually do think you need to warn owners that if that's the way you're going to get your diagnosis, that it can cause seeding. One recent study said the risk was only about 5%, but again, you definitely want to acknowledge it, because when it happens, you know, the owners could say it was your fault. So I have had a few cases where it's happened. So what are the other alternatives? This was, I just did a lecture with this with Craig Clifford at BMX, and this was his picture. This could be the picture that I have of Nemo, which was also a Bichon frise that had prostatic cancer. And we were actually doing stereotactic radiation. radiation, and we had to put a seed in the prostate, and that caused the subcutaneous seeding of the mass. But again, it is a risk. So the cytology of these are epithelial cells. But again, some of these can be really hard to figure out if they're reactive or are they malignant cells. So definitive diagnosis is usually going to be histology and not cytology because of all the inflammation in there. How are you going to get your biopsy? The surgical explore, right? You could do a cystotomy. Sometimes you can, if you have the equipment in your hospital, you can do cystoscopy or traumatic catheterization. All right. Well, that's all really invasive, really expensive, requires anesthesia. Wouldn't it be cool if there was a new test out there? Okay, and some of the other challenges, depending on the literature, 15 to 20% already have distant meds, and about 60% can have multiple metastasis to local lymph nodes, and many of these have been treated with multiple rounds of antibiotics. So again, we're seeing these cases way too late, and the diagnostics are invasive and hard to confirm. So what is this BRAF mutation? So there's recent studies that have identified this mutation, that's its official name and number, in the canine BRAF gene. And this was really pioneered by Dr. Breen at NC State, and then additional studies at the NIH lab confirmed this mutation, so it's been confirmed by a second lab. And what they identified is that a large proportion of dogs with uroepithelial carcinomas, so that includes your transitional cell carcinomas, and dogs with prostatic carcinomas, had this mutation. And they looked at other cancers as well. You know, they compared this to dogs with hematopoietic cancers and sarcomas. And they confirmed that the highest penetration rates were these dogs with these uroepithelial carcinomas. And the take-home message, it appeared to be an excellent diagnostic marker. So what does that mean for us? This is a PCR assay, and it detects this rare mutated sequence. You can use a free catch urine sample, and it's estimated about 83 to 85% that it can detect in those patients. It's been validated on hundreds of dogs. They compared those to healthy dogs, and they also compared it to dogs with other cystitis, other urinary tract infections. And that's where the bladder tumor antigen test failed us, right? Because if the dogs had inflammation in their urine, the test was not good. This test, they can have urinary tract infections, they can have inflammation, they can have chronic cystitis, and it can still distinguish them. So that's the really cool thing. So the test is called the Cadet BRAF assay. It's done by Central, is the company. It's done through NC State, but it's its own company. And again, it estimates that it can detect it in 85% of the cases. They've looked at over 300 cases, and they compared it to pathology. So 85% sensitive, 15% false negative, zero false positives, and 99.5% specific to uroepithelial and TCC. And again, it can be anywhere in the urinary tract. The hard part is that they say you need to collect 40 mLs of urine. A little bit hard for a chihuahua, right? So there is a way around it. So they are one of the most super helpful labs that I have worked with by email and getting on the phone. So if you have a small dog, so you will, when you order the lab, you have to submit it in their container, and it has a special preservative in it. And so if you're submitting 15 mLs of urine, they will tell you how much of the preservative to take out and dump. So you can adjust the proportion of preservative to the amount of urine. If you have 40 mLs of urine, you're just going to pop it in there and you'll mail it off and you get the results back in a couple of days. The other thing is the urine needs to go right into the container. So usually what we do is we send the container home with the urine. Don't have them catch it in the container, because if that knocks over, you're SOL, they have to buy another container. So I tell them to collect the urine and then pour it into the container and then bring it back down. Okay, and they give you all the details when you order the test. So it was launched in 2018. The test has been available, I think, since 2017. Just this last summer, they now have an add-on test. So if you submit it and it comes back negative for the BRAF mutation, they will say, would you like to add on this additional test? And that will increase the sensitivity from 85 to 95%. So you don't do it in all your cases, but if you run the test and it says negative for the BRAF mutation, they'll say, do you want to add on this test? Then you call, you pay the additional fee, they add it on, and that increases. So you can say up to 95% certainty that this case does not have TCC or uroepithelial carcinoma. Pretty cool? about the breeds that you might want to use it. It allows owners to direct their resources, towards treatment instead of diagnosis. And again, it does not get false positive because of inflammation or blood or protein or bacteria in the urine, and you get the results back really quickly. The other thing that I've been using it based on a lecture that I went to by Dr. Green is for monitoring. So you can use it for your TCC cases and your prostatic cases that you're treating with chemotherapy, and you can see the BRAF levels fall, and then you can see the BRAF levels go back up when they relapse. So it's also, they're not promoting it as that, but you can use it as a monitoring test as well. Okay, this is Sammy. He's a little Pomeranian that he has IBD. Do you recognize him?
Yes.
IBD, and he comes in and they run blood work and urine, and on a regular urine, they noticed that he had some white blood cells, no bacteria. We ran a urine culture, and the culture was negative. Oops, same slide. And the culture came back negative, and the owners, I'm treating their other dog. My husband's the internist who's taking care of this dog. The owners were very concerned that he might have cancer, so we ran the BRAF test, came back negative, did the add-on test, came back negative. So again, it's another good test to do, and he already had an ultrasound, his bladder was normal, but again, that's where I think about using this test. Okay? All right, then we're gonna finish up the last 10 minutes talking about inappetence. This is Jeter. In 2015, this is Jeter, this is my own cat that had IBD. He was diagnosed in 2010. In 2015, he stopped responding to therapy, and we started treating him more aggressively with Leuparin, and then he started to lose more weight, and I couldn't get this cat to eat. And it really, to me, drove home the challenges of having a pet at home that you can't get to eat. And I tried everything, different foods, heating his foods, acupuncture, and I just needed a better appetite stimulant. And there are no, I just felt like, especially for cats, we're so limited. So he was also, he's a lovely cat at home, but he was evil in the clinic. We tried Leuparin, and then he didn't respond to that, and then we started him on CHOP chemotherapy. This is when he was getting his first dose of doxorubicin, and he was growling the whole time through. But again, it really highlighted to me how frustrating it is to have a pet that doesn't eat, and then how happy you are.
Your eyes are chemo treatment. Is it boring? Is it good sniffing?
Are you when your pet is eating, right, that hasn't been eating? And the struggle as pet owners, like when our pets won't eat, and you're like, and they're eating something for 3 days and then they stop eating, right? So I'm so happy, but this is what most days are like. It's like the kitty buffet. So, and I think, inappetence, the more that I started to study this more recently, inappetence in veterinary medicine is so important, and I don't think we talk about it enough, and I don't think we focus on it enough in vet school, or if we did, I wasn't really paying attention, maybe. But more than 10 million dogs are estimated in the U.S. to present to their vet. Sometimes the only complaint, guys, right, is I can't get my pet to eat. And it may be the first sign and the only sign that our pet is ill. And sometimes it's just that they're not eating the same food, sometimes it's that they're just not eating as well, and sometimes it's that they won't eat at all. And if left untreated, right, that's horrible, right? That can just manifest and make the disease worse. And then there's nausea, which is common and underreported. Owners know what it's like when their pets vomit. They know that, right? They call you. They know that. But the nausea is really hard. And especially in the world of chemotherapy, it's really important that we get our pet owners to understand what nausea is, because we need to be very proactive and preventative. And people will stop treating their pets for chemotherapy if they stop eating. They'll handle vomiting. If their pets stop eating, they will stop coming in. They will stop therapy. And so what's really exciting and what we're focused on in this talk is that there are the new drugs that are on. So we're talking about Entyce and Miratex. And so, it's really hard when we tell our dog and cat owners, use as needed, because they often don't know what that means. And so you send them all of the medications and we think we're doing a good job, and if they don't use them, we're not doing a good job. So we need to make sure that pet owners know when to use it. So I often tell people, and my nurses, when you get a history and you say, how's the appetite? Often the pet owner will say, good. But good might mean that they hand-cooked and they sat on the floor for 30 minutes to get that pet to eat. That's not a good appetite. That pet needs support, and they need some of these new medications. So we want to ask, what are they eating? How much are they eating? And remember that taste can change, especially when they're going through chemotherapy. now, you know, Tyson is really very novel and very new, and I'm very excited it's on the market. And what's important is that this improved nutrition, guys, sometimes these pets come in, we don't know why they're not eating. Get them on a Tyson, get them on Miritax, figure out what the diagnosis is. And that's really, really important. I think a lot of these cases is as we're working them up, we get them on the appetite stimulants, and that gives us more time to investigate the diagnosis. So again, we want to be very proactive and not reactive. And so we want to find out, obviously, we're going to diagnose and manage it to treat the underlying disease. Are these animals painful? Are they nauseous? Do they need a nausea medication as well? But remember, what do pain medications cause? Inappetence, right? So if you're sending an animal home on pain medications and antibiotics, maybe they need an appetite stimulant as well, especially if they weren't eating as part of their presentation. They can heat their food and try different foods, but now we have some medications as well. So, you know, these are some of the different inappetence treatments that, you know, and again, I try to put them out of these, like acupuncture, ziprasidone, and things like that. You know, Serenia is labeled for nausea. It's not an appetite stimulant. So, I'm not going to really go through this, but basically the regulation of the appetite is the hypothalamus, the peripheral vagus system, or the peripheral nervous system, the vagus nerve, and really ghrelin. And why ghrelin is important is entice is a ghrelin agonist. And the reason that that is important is these are all the brakes on the system. These are all the things that prevent a dog, a cat, and a person from eating. You know what's the only thing that is the accelerator? Ghrelin. Ghrelin is the only thing that is going to promote animals to eat. So we need to give them a ghrelin agonist, and that's finally what we have with Entyce. So Entyce is a ghrelin agonist. It's an appetite stimulant. It's been available since 2017. Who's using it? Who likes it? Okay. So, and I think what, and I feel like I was kind of using it wrong in the beginning. And so I'll give you a couple of tips with me in the last couple of minutes for how I've changed how I've been using it, that I think that is better. So it mimics the hunger hormone. It's effective and safe. And again, why are you figuring out why the pet's not eating? Get them on Entyce. It's FDA approved. It's FDA approved in dogs and can be used off-label in cats. And comes with three different bottles. So again, it mimics ghrelin, makes animals think that they're hungry, stimulates them to eat. Be careful if they have hepatic or renal dysfunction, though I have used them cautiously in both. And I find it very well tolerated. So where I really think a good use for it is in these chronic cases. So cancer, GI disease, chronic kidney disease, heart failure, these palliative. You can use it in acute cases as well when they're coming in, but I find really good uses for the chronic ones. And so what I have found is, especially when I'm not sure, because a lot of these cases I'm telling you, like, are they nauseous or what? Are they not eating because they're painful or because of another cause? I will use Serenia and Entyce for a couple of days. And then I will tell the owners to give both for 2 days and then continue the Entyce. I have seen much better responses with Entyce with that. And I tell the owners to give Entyce 5 days. You know, a lot of owners expect that they're going to give one magical dose of Entyce and their animals or their pets are going to eat. I have had some pets give one magical dose of Entyce and they sent me an email. An hour later, they ate. But a lot of the times, we need to use it a little bit more chronically. So again, if I'm not sure if it's nausea, or maybe they're vomiting as well, I use Entyce and Serenia, and then for both for 2 days, and then I continue Entyce. Okay. And then finally, Miritax. I mentioned this a little bit in the cat lecture. So mirtazapine, you know, is a human antidepressant. We don't know the mechanism of action, why in people it makes them eat. One of the side effects when they're using it as an antidepressant in people is it causes an increase in appetite and causes them to gain weight, which people are not always excited about. But that would be a great one for some of our patients. So they've looked at it in chronic kidney disease, in cats as an appetite stimulant, and for vomiting. The problem is we don't know the right dose. There were some studies that originally in cats, you know, some of the older versions of Plum said to use it every third day, 3.75 mg per kg. Some of these cat studies, the Quimby studies, are saying give 1.88 mg every other day. So basically you have a cat lick a pill, you know, like it comes in 15 mg, that's like an eighth of a pill. It also comes in a 7.5. So it's really hard to dose and we don't really know the right dose. And you know what, it's not FDA labeled to be giving oral mirtazapine. And then in dogs, they looked at cats and they measured, did they gain weight? It's a transdermal ointment that's put on the ear daily. And in the placebo double-blinded study, cats did gain weight versus placebo. And these are the different receptors that it stimulates, and it causes cats to gain weight. So, So again, it's a tube, they put it on the finger, and then I think they recommend alternating, you know, each day going back and forth between the ear and how happy the kitty cat is because he's gonna eat. But again, anyone ever have to pill their own cat? Oh my God, I cannot pill Jeter for the life of me. So, you know, pilling cats is not great. Anything transdermal, I think, is a great, great option. So, and that is available for most distributors. And then the other thing, you know, again, I just think it's really important for our dogs and cats who are going through chemo to make sure that they're going home with their Serenia, their metronidazole, their probiotic. I'm sending more dogs home, especially for these dogs that are not eating when they come in. You know, they're going home with enticing and their goodie bag. And then cats, if they're not eating, they're getting Miritaz in their goodie bag the first day as well. So again, you want to give them a detailed instruction sheet and really, really educate their clients about what is nausea and what is incontinence and being really proactive. I have chemotherapy information sheets that are available on my website in the pet owner resource section. You're more than welcome to print them out and use them as well. This is just, you know, an information sheet about giving chemo, and this is what is nausea look like, what is vomiting and things like that. I do need to update these and add enticing and Miritaz, but it does at least walk the owners through. There's also some stuff there about home safety with chemotherapy. So this is my kitty Jeter. I told you that picture when we gave him doxorubicin. This is that day, sitting on the couch with my kitty. We euthanized him a couple days later. I had a lot of concerns about giving chemo to my own kitty and, you know, being around children, but then I remembered that it was okay. But sometimes we're moms more than we are pets. But again, important, you know, when we think about incontinence, we want to be very proactive, especially in our pets with chronic conditions. And like I mentioned, owners will discontinue therapy, other, you know, not just chemotherapy as well, if their pets are not eating, because they really associate happy pets eating. Pets that are not eating are not happy and they're suffering. So I think it's really important. And now we have more tools in our toolbox. And for the pet, you know, it leads to weight loss, muscle wasting, and cachexia. And for cancer, there are studies that show that, you know, that is associated with shorter survival times. And that treatments are less effective. And quality of life is really the primary concern. And again, vomiting is often considered an acceptable side effect for dogs and cats going through chemotherapy, but weight loss and depression were considered unacceptable. So again, I think we know it's really important. All right, so Tinovia, finally a new drug for lymphoma. I'm really excited. I think the other thing that will be interesting in the future is to see maybe Tinovia will start finding its way into the CHOP protocol and seeing how that, and maybe that will start improving those survival times there. Lymphoma vaccine, I think now that we're using it early, we'll start to see some better results there. I'm excited about that. Osteosarcoma, I think that's also really, really exciting that we're gonna start to see improvement in survival times, finally. Novel testing for, and again, I use transitional cell carcinoma and neuroepithelial.